I'm going to give a talk on the vascular surgery and GMS. He'll be here for the talk after the surgery. So how many of you have done vascular surgery or doing the vascular surgery? Anyone involved in vascular surgery?
Long time ago.
Yeah.
I'm just going to skip this. So again, the function of the intraoperative monitoring is to protect the neural structure and the nervous system at risk. So we can do, we can use the different modalities to test either directly the function of the brain, spinal cord, brainstem, or indirectly we can also check the ischemic changes. So if there's ischemic changes to the brain or brainstem or peripheral nerves, spinal cord, there will be a change in the signal. So we can indirectly, if there's a change in signal and this because of ischemia, we know we can pick up that in our data. So there are different type of surgical procedures. So some of them are not causing any, so the vessel, like vessel and involving the vessels, aneurysms, carotid artery, angioplasty, spinal cord, AVM, they are procedure, they are not, they are involving the vascular structure, they are not involving the nervous tissue, but because any clipping or blocking of those vessels can affect the nerve conduction, and patient can wake up with a deficit, so we can do different type of monitoring and can help with the patient. So again, we have all the different modalities we discussed today. Sensory evoked potential, we can do motor evoked potential, we can do EEG for brain ischemia, SSP, we can monitor the dorsal column pathways, posterior spinal artery, we can use the SSP for monitoring the circulation of the brain stem and brain, motor evoked potential for descending pathway, to monitor all the motor pathway, for EMG for protecting the brain ischemia, EMG we can do the any ischemic changes to the cranial nerves or the peripheral nerves, we can do visual evoked potential to monitor the blood flow, especially for any pre-chiasmic. So we don't do intraoperative VEP for any post-chiasmic procedure, because pre-chiasmic, the optic nerve, left and right, they are the medial fiber, they cross over. So post-chiasmic, so the right optic tract has a fiber from the left side and right side. So we cannot do prediction more accurately in the OR, so because of other factors. So we, so even the surgeon asks you the occipital lobe, which is the optic visual path, visual lobe, we don't do those intraoperatively because we can have more false negative outcome. So we do only, so any ophthalmic aneurysms or any aneurysms involving the frontal lobe or frontal lobe, we can do add a visual lobe potential there. Auditory protection of the auditory pathway, so any blood circulation around the brainstem, including the basilar artery, posterior pica, fetal pica, ICA, or we can do auditory evoked potential, and again, TCD, with Dr. Lodorowski, he discussed with that yesterday that we're adding a transcranial Doppler in this procedure, we can do direct measurement of the blood flow to the brain. Again, stressing on the multimodality monitoring, there's not a single modality we can do, so depending on structure, if it is a carotid artery, we do SSCP and EEG, and sometimes we do a motor evoked potential. There's a controversy about motor evoked potential, but you can add motor evoked potential, but SSCP, adding two modalities increases the protection many more fold. So there are a lot of paper published, especially there are a couple of paper published from USC, Dr. Belzer group, having EEG, comparing EEG or SSP with EEG and SSP for carotid artery, have more neural protection. So type of vascular procedure, there are two main types. We have extracranial vascular procedure and we have intracranial vascular procedure. The extracranial vascular procedure, anything below the head, which is carotid endarterectomy or transcarotid artery revascularization or TCAR, I don't know if you mean about. So and the difference between this was with the TCAR, the blood flow is reverse blood flow, so the blood flow is not going to the brain, but it's going away from the brain. What that helps is the, if there's an emboli kind of emboli going, instead of going to the brain, they go away from the brain. The intracranial procedures to be typically do monitoring is cerebral aneurysms, arteriovenous malformation, and STA and MCA bypass. So patient with vascular diseases, especially Moyamoya disease. They do extracranial, intracranial bypass, so we can do in that too. The other I didn't mention is extracranial is spinal cord embolization. We have published a paper on that. So spinal cord embolization is just like a water test. Do you know water test? What is a water test? Anyone?
Yes.
Water. So water test we do like to by doing the EEG for mostly for speech mapping before the speech mapping to see which side of the brain is active. So we can do a spinal water which we inject different lidocaine or propofol and run SSCP and MEP. And if there's a change, we don't embolize that vessel because the arterial venous malformation is formed by the abnormal connection between arteries and vein. It can be in the brain, spinal cord, or any other any tissue. So if it's in the spinal cord, in order to protect any bleeding or rupture, you the surgeon, they go and to the coil, either do surgery, open the surgery, and they burn it out and take it out, or they do interventional, they put glue and embolize that. So the blood doesn't go. If the blood doesn't go, it's blocked, there'll be no rupture. But if you block the vessel, which is also supplying the sensory pathway or motor pathway, patient will be paralyzed or have a loss of sensory function. So we can do temporary testing, which is injecting lidocaine or propofol, and then we run the SSP and MEP, and there's no change, then they can embolize that vessel. So vascular surgeries, cranial vascular surgeries, again, the aneurysms, AVM, microvascular decompression, extracranial, intracranial bypass, and tumors. So the monitoring modality we can use is EEG, SSCP, MEP, direct cortical motor evoked potential, TCD, auditory evoked potential, and VP. As I mentioned before, it's not recommended to do transway motor evoked potential if there's a supratentorial tumor or supratentorial vascular structure, because when you're doing transcranial motor evoked potential, the current is going, it may be going to below the surgical side, below the aneurysm side. If it is AVM or ACOM, they're very deep, so that's transcranial may be okay, but you have to be very careful with the threshold and the stimulation location. So the idea will be doing direct cortical stimulation in those. You can, because the brain is open, you can open, put the grid on and run stimulation throughout the grid, throughout the surgery. The risk is ischemia to the due to retractor, because they're putting the retractor, they're pushing the brain. Ischemia due to the temporary clips. The temporary clips sometimes can be is misplaced on the wrong vessel, and if it's misplaced on the wrong vessel, you see the changes in your sensory evoked potential, motor evoked potential, or EEG changes. Ischemia due to decrease in mean artery pressure. Sometimes you have to decrease the mean artery pressure, or decrease the cause by vasodilation or something, so there's no bleeding or decrease in bleeding. Clipping of the perforator, accidental clipping of the perforators, clipping of the other vessels, and also vasospasm. So all these factors can make changes, and we can use all these modalities depending which structure that is in which place. The second extracranial procedure is carotid endarterectomy or stenting and balloon occlusion. So have you ever done carotid endarterectomy, anyone? So carotid endarterectomy, if you have the one who have not done carotid endarterectomy, the patient come with a stroke-like symptom, they have vasospasm or something, and they do carotid ultrasound, Doppler. So many times the patient has a 99% block on one side and have 98% or 70%. So you have to go and make an incision, open the carotid artery, take the cheeseburger, and throw it away. That's all your teeth. So you have to take out, so whatever you can, direct inject in your vessels instead of eating. But, so those are the blockers, those are high risk for stroke. So when you block, when you're taking those, that fat out of that, you can cause dislodge. So there are couple of ways how to monitor that. If there's no monitoring available, there are many thousands of hospitals, they have no monitoring, they do awake carotid endarterectomy. If they do awake carotid endarterectomy, it's not a fun to do that. It's very uncomfortable with the patient, uncomfortable with the anesthesiologist and the surgeon. So if you keep the patient awake, if it's the right carotid artery, they ask the patient to move the right hand and keep talking to the patient, if sort of, and when they clamp, so 15% of the patient population, 10 to 15% patient, they don't have a good collateral circulation. So if you block the common carotid, there'll be no blood supply, and we don't know which 15% are there. So we cannot take the guess. So we keep the patient awake and ask the patient starts weak, they put the shunt. That's a selective shunting. The second method is you cannot keep the patient awake, you just surgeon go and just put the shunt in. Do you know what the shunt is? Shunt is a bypass, it's a small plastic tube, it has two sharp tips, but when you're putting the those shunt in 100% of patient, you, because if you're not doing monitoring, you don't have a carotid duplex done, you don't have a TCD going on at the same time. When you prick through the vessel, it can dislodge a clot and patient have a stroke intraoperatively. So you have a high risk of stroke, even if you want to prevent that. So for the best thing is when you add your intraoperative monitoring and you have a SSCP, EMG, and TCD, you can actually count the number of emboli going in there. There are one emboli, two emboli, three, or you're higher, you can stop the manipulation, you can give some warfarin, anticoagulant to decrease that. Then we do, it's called selective shunting. If there's a change in the SSCP and MP, you do selective shunting. The other one is stenting, so you put the balloon stenting or you put the end open. So again, the modalities we use, those are the four most common modalities used for carotid endarterectomy: EG, SSCP, MAP, and TCD. The risk factors are again due to retractors, so you can make changes because of ischemia, you can pull recurrent laryngeal nerve, patient can wake up with a recurrent hoarse voice or change in the voice. Temporary keep emboli is the most common risk, so the highest risk is intraoperatively, followed by the within same for 24 hour postoperatively, they still have a high risk of stroke. Aortic vascular procedures, aortic arch repair, thoracoabdominal aneurysms, bypass procedures, we can use EEG, SSP, MEP, and TCD monitoring because the spinal cord is at risk. So in order to repair an aortic arch or abdominal aneurysm, you have to go and clamp the aorta. Aorta is clamped, there's no blood supply to the So technically, when you're doing SSP, there's no SSP because the patient temperature is 16 degree, 17 degree, so SSP is gone. The EEG we are monitoring, but there's no EEG because patient is continuous blood suppression. So what we are monitoring is blood suppression. We make sure patient is not getting any burst. When you stop warming up the patient, you start getting every burst every 10 minutes, and then so you have window of 10 minutes or 30 minutes. So you can see every burst every 30 minutes, then a 10 minute, and 1 minute, and then the patient wakes up. But and you can do motor evoke potential and TCD. TCD, there are study we did. I was involved in some study comparing because if the patient is in a bypass machine, that can dislodge air emboli. So you can put a TCD on one end of the both end of the artificial flow machine, and you can count the emboli if there's any emboli coming from your air emboli coming from the machine. So the risk of ischemia to the spine, the emboli, vessel spasms, blood suppression. So all of those we are giving. Interventional vascular procedures. So if the surgeon can do procedure in an intervention suite, they don't have to operate, they don't have to open the spinal cord, or they don't have to open the brain and spine. So they just put a catheter to the femoral artery and go all the way to the aneurysm or wherever they want to, and they just do coiling or angioplasty or stent. Now we can do a radial artery, because femoral artery, when you do that, so the patient cannot walk for a few days because there's a lot of bleeding and swelling in the groin area. But selected patient, you can do in the radial artery. So you can put the catheter to the radial artery and patient is out same day. It's a drive-through surgery.
Is that all the modalities you're doing for?
Interventional, do EG, SSP, MEP, ABR, yeah. Are
you all
of them, depending.
Coiling?
So yeah, if it's a coiling in ACOM, like for anterior communicating artery or anterior cerebral artery aneurysm, your lower limbs are at risk. So you want to do SSCP and motor evoke potential of lower limb. You want to have EEG at the beginning at the same time. If it is a MCA, then you do the same three things. If it is a posterior circulation, basilar artery, we add auditory evoke potential because depending, it is a fetal being.
They do some of these awake though, don't they?
Sorry?
They do some of these awake.
They do awake too, yeah.
So then we, because I was just doing EEG for the awake ones.
So if you do awake, then you don't do motor evoke potential.
But you still do the
especially don't try cough screws. Yeah.
So the pair you run both of them together.
Yes. Both of them together.
Yeah.
But the reason they do awake because there's no monitoring. If they are comfortable with your, they're trusting your capabilities, they are not going to do awake. Awake is not fun. Because patient is moving and you have a coil in the, you have a catheter inside the, and it ruptures. So you, so with the neuro mounting, you have a good mounting, good modality, multimodality, you can put the patient sleep and just, that's the reason doing awake, so they can monitor the functional status, patient getting delirious, dizzy.
Or when you're doing EEG, you don't put a full, you use like a neonatal montage, or you put on a full set of?
If you're doing EEG NSFP, then you do, you don't do 16 channel, you do 8 channel EEG.
Like
if you do just EEG, then you do 16 channel EEG for full. So just a summary, so all these surgery procedure, intracranial aneurysm, intracranial coiling, clipping, microvascular decompression. So microvascular decompression has, you have vessels there, ECIC bypass, carotid endarterectomy, carotid stents, spinal AVM. I talk about spinal AVM, so you can embolize, it's called selective embolization. You don't want to embolize all the vessels, especially if they're not. So you put the lidocaine and then you put a propofol or thiopental, and wait for 1 minute and 2 minutes, run MEP, run SSEP, there's no change, go to the next vessel, third vessel, the all vessel no change, and if the one of the four vessels is changing, you don't embolize that, you just embolize the remaining three of them. So role of neuromonitoring team is offer monitoring to major vascular surgeries, use of appropriate modalities, so having appropriate modalities much. So having knowing the anatomy is the key point. So is it a surgery done in the anterior fossa, middle fossa, posterior fossa? So if you don't know the anatomy, then don't walk in as a spine case and say, okay, I'm doing that. So because if it's, I'm just giving an example, I was doing an interventional procedure with it's an aneurysm of M2, MCA. And during the case, the EEG technically is more sensitive than SSEP and MEP in these cases because EEG is a postsynaptic potential and they get disrupted by ischemia. But we have changes in SSEP. We ran MEP, we had loss of MEP on one side. It stops, so told the surgeon stop. We did angiography and there was a microclot there at the same time with some swelling. So it, the surgeon revascularized, he took out that, opened the area and revascularized, and patient was fine. But that was intraoperative stroke while we were doing monitoring. And we picked up by changes because we have multimodality monitoring. If we were doing just EEG, unfortunately there was no change in EEG and there was a change in SSP and MEP. So we picked up with that and then revascularized. Otherwise this patient had a postoperative endocrine stroke. So each modality detects specific area. EEG is for cortical ischemia and to monitor the bus suppression. SSP is for all the sensory pathway. SSP also indirectly monitoring because as we talk, one third of the motor fiber, they are originating from post-synaptic gyrus. Posterior tibial for anterior circulation, median nerve SSP. We do ulnar for positioning and all those things, but for craniotomy, because median nerve has a bigger area, so we want to have median nerve SSP in these cases. You can still add ulnar if you want to do positioning, but median nerve is the key for the posterior nerve. Some of the centers, they don't even do tibial nerve for MCA, but we do tibial and median for all the cases. TCMEP for motor tract, direct cortical stimulation. So direct cortical stimulation is very useful. So because TCMEP patient jumps a lot, direct cortical patient is not jumping. But if you're there, and the direct motor, cortical motor, there are two methods. One is Taniguchi and one Penfield. Penfield is the oldest method since 1850. But with Penfield, because of very long pulse, you stimulate for 400-500 microseconds for 3-4 seconds, patient can have seizure. There's a high risk of seizure, about 15-30% patient have seizures. But the Taniguchi, which was published in 1993, is a short train pulse, but very high frequency. It's known as high frequency short train pulse, just like MEP, but it's anodal stimulation. So you put the anode on the cortex and cathode on the forehead and stimulate with the four pulses, a very short pulse, high frequency, four pulses only, instead of if you're doing Penfield, you're doing 50 hertz for 5 seconds, it's 250 pulses stimulation. Compared to Taniguchi, you have 4 pulses. And with, for less than few minutes, 20 milliseconds instead of not even 1 second. So very low risk of, we have done like dozens of cases and we have seen, so far we have zero. On the Penfield, we have like many, many seizures. So we can do these cases, we can do very quickly. So you can run Taniguchi like nonstop and get good feedback. Again, if it's a posterior circulation, we do both brainstem auditory growth potential. And if it's an ophthalmic aneurysm or something, frontal lobe, you can add for vascular procedure, we can add frontal. We don't add for posterior cerebral artery. And intravascular Doppler, we already have discussed that. So blood velocity for anterior, posterior, and middle. TCD, we do mostly for carotid endarterectomy, sometimes in others for the aneurysm clipping, we do micro Doppler. Dr. Pavlovsky was showing it. It's a very small micro Doppler you can just put on that. You can do it in a spinal procedure, you can do it in the cranial, and you can measure the blood flow. But we can, for transcranial Doppler, you can just probe. In craniotomy, it's not possible, but carotid, we do that. Again, so when we do intraoperative TCD, we are just monitoring MCA. We don't do anterior circulation or posterior circulation because we are clamping the common carotid. He mentioned yesterday, the common carotid is supplying, MCA is supplying 70% of the blood supply of the brain. So MCA, the change in MCA, you have changes in your anterior and posterior. So you don't need to have all the things. For clinical study, you need to do all the things. Again, we already talk about cerebral aneurysm, so there are different locations, so depending on the posterior, middle, brainstem, so these are all different locations where they can. Endovascular embolization, so embolization of the aneurysm, so the surgeon can embolize that. So the aneurysm is just a weakening in the arterial wall. So then it's a small, it gets bigger and bigger because the blood goes in, it stays there, and the patient is hypertensive. Mostly it's a hypertensive patient, get bigger and bigger. And either you can go and put a clamp there and just tie it. If you cannot do that, or you don't want to do craniotomy, you can go to the groin, femoral artery, you can go to radial artery and put this card, and when you detach, so it's very coily, that's why it's called coil. So you put 1, 2, 3, 4. The largest I have done is 32 coils in one aneurysm. So you can, depending on the size of the coil, but you need to have a bigger neck. This is called neck. So the neck is very wide. You cannot, because every time you put coil, it will come out. And if it comes out, that's horrible. Don't try it home. Give it to a professional. So okay, it's not for personal use only. So because even the expert, because when it's a detachment, that's why monitoring is helpful. When you detach, it can detach, but just spring out and cause rupture, and then you have to emergency craniotomy. I've done few, it's not fun. Yeah, because interventional suite is not OR suite, it's a different suite with all the, and patient has a rupture, you take the patient running to the operating room, and all the electrodes are attached, already attached, which is a good thing. And once this full, the surgeon injects. It's not always surgeon, it can be done by neurosurgeon, it can be done by radiologist do that, it can be done by neurologist. Again, don't try it. But anyone can do that. So when you inject the glue, it quickly freeze and it makes a big ball, so the blood doesn't go, and then. So if the neck is big, they put a stent, so it block, and then they put the blood in there. You can see that this is before. Angiography, you can see the posterior basilar artery and the left and right. And there is a big aneurysms, and after the coiling is gone, so it's, the blood is not going there, so you don't see that blood going. Spinal AVM, we published the paper, spinal AVM. So AVM is in the spinal cord, and you have multiple feeders, if you got feeders, and you inject the dye in 1, 2, 3 feeder and see the changes in MEP or SSEP. Spinal AVM, so they appear and they can just. So with the monitoring, we can have a very good. Again, I always like to show the worst data on the cell because that's what you see in the OR, correct? So I can show you very nice waveform. Cortical SAP chamber, this is one of the keys. I don't know, I think it's carotid. So always, like every time you're doing such case where you have a risk of changing, you need to have a stack. And how many of you monitor stack every day? Continuously. Do you monitor stack? Just two? Three?
Yeah.
So you should have average window and stack window going at the same time, because sometimes you cannot see the change, big change on the average waveform. But if you have a stack, even a blind person can tell that, correct? Not making it too, I'm serious. So burst suppression, so we're doing EEG for burst suppression. So it's EEG for burst. For aneurysm, we want to have burst suppression because there's a risk of clipping the wrong artery. The surgeons are trained to do that, not trained to clip the wrong vessel, they're trained to do that surgery. But the anatomy is very, very variable. So you go from one patient to the other, one to the other patient, it's always variable. And there's so much different pathology, so there's a risk of that. So you want to have burst suppression, so there's less demand by the brain. For carotid case, we don't want burst suppression, so we are on. But you need to have a longer window so to see how many bursts we have. This is a case we have like EEG going on, and at the upper is left and right median. So you can connect your microscope, so all the equipment, we have Medtronic, Edwell, they have video input options, so you can connect the microscope and have a cable in, and you can watch that, especially if you're doing a triggered EMG or something. So it's very, very useful. So you don't ask them, the surgeon, what's happening, or the surgeon stimulating, you can do about the case. Fission or ABR, so a very nice ABR on the left side, and the right side is the one you get every time. Every time they bring the microscope, it looks like this, correct? And then you have fission EMG. Sensory, cortical sensory mapping, motor mapping, we also do mapping it, for these cases. For vascular cases, not only for tumor cases, because there's AVM, which is very in the central circus or pre or post central gyrus. This is like eloquent tissue. You don't want to take it out before you map the area. So we do sensory mapping, we do motor mapping, and then tell the surgeon this hand area, the face area, before he's going to burn that tissue and take this out. So this one you can see pre central down and up. This is central, and I like 2x4. I don't like 1x4 grid, because if you have 1x4 grid, then you don't have this side of the screen. And you tell the surgeon this is pre-central, this is post-central, so it looks like the central circus is going straight. Central circus is never going straight. It goes, you can have between, in this picture you have between 1 and 2 and 5 and 6, so you can go straight, but sometimes you can tell. So direct cortical stimulation. This is pen field method, so when you're stimulating with pen field, because it's a multiple stimulation, so you see multiple responses. This is 50 hertz stimulation, so every response is after 20 milliseconds. And we do EMG and we do electrocardiography. You can see stimulation artifact followed by no seizure, so which is good. Time as it decreases, so this is temporary clipping. So you can see the changes here. This is left. So cortical changes, subcortical changes, so cortical inside on left side but not on the right side. So this decrease lasted for 90 minutes, post-surgical motor language loss, cortical stroke. This patient has a cortical stroke and did not, even that signal came back a little bit, but patient has cortical stroke on the post-operative. Ideal anesthesia, again total intravenous anesthesia. With fentanyl and bolus, if you're not doing motor evocation, you can give muscle relaxant. And the biggest fear the surgeon has when he's clipping or she's clipping, the aneurysm is patient going to move. So you are under the microscope and you're trying to clip and patient move, he's going to rupture. So it's very hard to convince a surgeon to run MEP because they want the patient to paralyze. So there's no zero. But if the, I have a surgeon, he never, every time I ask him, he said, I don't want MEP. And one day I asked him, why you don't want MEP? He said, I have a patient moved and I'm scared. So he was not about monitoring, he was not trusting the anesthesia. He said, I don't trust these guys, this patient always moves. Talk about the effect of hypotension, again, so beside the changes, you have effect of hypotension and all those parasurgical, hypoperfusion. So if there's a hyperperfusion during the surgery, because if it's a craniotomy or decrease in the blood flow, you will have significant changes. The normal blood flow is about 50 cc per minute, and if it drops to 25 cc, you have significant change in clinical exam. If it drops below 20, you see changes in intraoperative changes. Hypothermia, so anything about 32 degrees centigrade, there's no change, and you have 30, below 30 is moderate change on EEG, and 20 to 20 degrees centigrade, you have a discontinuous pattern, and below 17, you have isoelectric, you have no EEG. Auditory evoke potential, that's a very easy formula. Every 1 degree every 1 degree decrease in every 1 degree centigrade, there's 1 millisecond delay. So you have three body temperature 37 is moved to 34, you have 3 millisecond delay on wave 5. And if you have 6, 7, it's out of the screen and you lose that. The SSCP again below 28, you have significant effect. Below 25, you lose your SSCP. So limitation, what the limitation we have? Anesthesia does not cooperate, always, correct? Surgeon does not cooperate. Lack of trained technologists in the room. In the IUM, lack of experienced neurophysiologists in for doing vascular surgeries. Technical problem we get from the equipment. Patient has pre-existing deficit. And the IUM equipment you have sometimes is not enough channel to do that. I did one case, it was a midline tumor brainstem. I was using 32 channel machine and 116 channel machine. So running at the same time, I had full 16 channel EEG, bilateral cortical mapping, bilateral cranial nerve 5 to 12, and bilateral upper and lower SSP, bilateral upper and lower MEP, and direct sensory mapping, motor mapping, cortical mapping. So I need to have. So monitoring setup was not that difficult. The difficult part was combining the data and uploading as the same patient. I'm just kidding. Setup was difficult. So what are we doing? So we need to think of body as a connection, just as a connection. There are different connections. So you have we talk about the pathway, the sensory pathway, the first order neuron, second order neuron, third order neuron. So all the neurons, you stimulate the PTN. You have from PTN to PUF-fossa to cervical, cervical to cortical. There's no synapse under cervical. And then your first synapse at brainstem, and then your second. So if there's a change in anything, then you can, this is a case of ACOM. So you can see midline parietal cortex, so have 37 and 45. So while they were putting clips, so ACOM is in midline, it's connecting left and right ACA, anterior cerebral artery. So if there's a ischemia to that or the clip that, it's going to affect both left and right cortical SSCP. So again, active monitoring, it should be always active monitoring. Never do the passive monitoring. Passive monitoring is what you run SSCP every 10 minutes or 15 minutes. You're running at a motor evo potential every. MEP is very, very sensitive for gray matter ischemia, we talk about. So you're doing EEG, you clamp the vessel. So you have 60% changes occur in the first 20 seconds. First 60 seconds, you have 80% changes. First 2 minutes, 99%. So you have, it's so fast changes in EEG. MEP, less than 2 minutes, you have cortical ischemia, spinal cord ischemia, gray matter ischemia occur in the first 2 minutes. Reversible, it can be reversed. It can be, it's not even two minutes, maybe late. But after 4 minutes, it's irreversible changes. But if the ischemia to the below corpus callosum, it's a white matter tract, it can be reversible up to 8 or 10 minutes, but irreversible about 18, 20 minutes. So you have to do continuous monitoring because you need to acquire the data as fast as possible. Equipment selection of the appropriate equipment, selection of the appropriate technologist, also selection of appropriate neurologist, because everyone has to be comfortable with doing these type of cases and they've done that. It's not do one and train one or two. Forgot the quote. Okay, important. So take home message is step up for always, in these cases, always set up for peripheral responses because you need to see the changes is because of the stimulation problem, recording problem. Don't rely on brachial plexus responses. Include papillary fossa if you have, can I say I have brachial, I'm not doing papillary fossa, I do both of them. Subcortical should be recorded. So you need to add cortical and subcortical. I can tell you how to do the subcortical for N18. Because for N18 response, which to monitor the thalamus, you cannot monitor a montage which is recording subcortical response. You cannot monitor which is cortical. So if you're stimulating right median nerve, you record from ipsilateral cortical to contralateral Erb's point. Because ipsilateral cortical will have no N20 at 30, it will have no 13, 14, and it will have no N9 and 10 because Erb's point is. And you're doing left side, you do ipsilateral cortical to contralateral Erb's point. That's for N18. Multimodal monitoring and active monitoring should be performed again. This is just a so this is how they're doing coiling. So they're putting the coil through the this is the rupture. So this is the tube and it's disc detaching the coil. So if you are doing all multi-modality monitoring in these type cases, so these type cases need monitoring. So there's a good justification. There's a hundreds of paper, they justify the changes you can pick up and improve the patient outcome. Just a TCD, patient have a going under carotid endarterectomy, they have very high risk of post-operative cognitive deficit, which is not paralysis, but they have issues with memory and everything. But if you have a higher number of strokes or hits, which is high intensity transient ischemia, so patient will have 5 year or 1 year, it will have more cognitive deficit. So you can decrease the cognitive deficit by using TCD monitoring. And also, correct selection of the monitoring model is important, again. And that's it, thank you. Any questions? I'm going to connect everyone to a motor remote potential machine.
When you're running pairs on these cases, you don't have to run them individually, right? You can run both together, right? If you're looking just for like...
You can run, but best to run individually, or left and right together, because you are depending, you're monitoring the contralateral, because we have 4 and 5 coming from the contralateral side, so you're changing ischemia to the left side versus the right side. So if you're running continuously, so it can overlap. Because we have 1, 2, 3 is coming from ipsilateral side, 4, 5 is coming from contralateral side. So the right side as well.
If you're looking for brainstem ischemia,
yeah.
You can just run both of them together.
You can, yeah. I don't see that much.